33. The basic criteria for hijab for the women, the complete body should be covered, except the face and the hands appearance can be seen. Some scholars say this also should be covered. The clothes should be loose. The clothes should not be transparent. It should not be glamorous. It should not be visible the opposite sex. It should not be visible the unbelievers. Furthermore, Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Azab, chapter 33, verse 59, O Prophet, tell your wives and your daughters and the blue women, when they go abroad, they should put on the cloak, they should put on the abaya. In the local language, it's abaya. Now they go in jilbab. So that they shall be recognized and it will prevent them from being molested. I would like to ask a question that if you are in Bombay, I don't know where you come from, and if the two twin sisters who are very beautiful, equally beautiful, one is wearing the Western clothes or the French clothes, mini skirts and shorts, and the other twin sisters, she is wearing the Islamic hijab, complete body covered except the face and the hands of the wrist. And if both these twin sisters, equally beautiful, walking down the streets and down the, round the corner, there is a hooligan who is waiting for a catch, who is going to tease the girl. I am asking the question, which girl will it tease? Will it tease the girl wearing the Islamic hijab or will it tease the girl wearing the mini skirt for short? Which girl will it tease? Correct. So, Islam, the hijab protects the women. So there, here in Saudi Arabia, whether you are a Muslim woman or a non-Muslim woman, we don't want any woman to be teased. Therefore, Quran says, when a man looks at a woman, in Surah Nur chapter 24, verse number 30, when a man looks at a woman and if any broken thought comes, he should lower his gaze. That is the hijab for the man. For the woman, she should wear the hijab. Both should do. In the foreign country, they may like the woman to be teased. It's their prerogative. There, when our sister goes, when our mothers go, we don't want them to be molested, we don't want them to be teased. In, do you know America? One of the highest rate of rape is in America. You know that. According to FBI Stats of 1990, it says that every day on average 1,756 rapes took place. In 1996, according to US Department of Justice, every day 2,713 cases of rape took place. Every 30 seconds, one rape took place. We have this all day for more than 3 hours. More than 3 hours. Already, more than 300 rapes have taken place in America. I am asking you a question that if we implement the Sharia in America, any man looks at a woman, any broken thought comes lower his gaze. After that, the woman should be dressed up properly in hijab, complete body covered except the face and hand of the wrist. After that, if any man rapes a woman, capital punishment, death penalty. I am asking the question, will the rate of rape in America, will it rise? Will it remain the same or will it go down? What will happen? It will increase, remain the same or will it decrease? It will decrease. It's a practical law. You implement the Sharia, you get results. So we love all the human beings. All the women, whether they're Muslim or non-Muslim, we respect them and we protect them. That's the reason when a non-Muslim woman comes to Saudi Arabia, we say we want to be protected. Therefore, it's compulsory to uplift and not to degrade her. Hope that answers the question.
Okay, excuse me, brother. We have to give a chance to the others, please. We will take the last two questions, one from the ladies and then the brothers over here. We're sorry because of the time now. The ladies, we have a sister who wants to ask a question. Go ahead, please.
Sister asked the question that she comes from the West and there are teenagers and in the 20s, ladies who are born Muslims, but they want to become Christians. So what should I do? How should I get them back to the deen? Sister, the best way that maybe they are influenced with the Western culture, they are influenced by the Western culture, with the glamour, etc. So the best way you can get them back is to speak the good things about our deen. And the best you can do is that I've given a talk on women's rights in Islam. And in that lecture of mine, I've divided the rights of women into 6 broad headings, which deals each one in detail. So if you see that tape, or you give that tape, or you can repeat what is there in the tape to the sisters, And what you have to realize that Islam is a religion that uplifts the women. That is the reason today the fastest growing religion in the world is Islam. And amongst those people becoming Muslims, non-Muslims, two-thirds of them, they are women. So if Islam subjugates the women, why will the non-Muslim Americans, non-Muslim Europeans accept Islam, the ladies? Because Islam gives them protection. So Islam is the best religion that can give them protection. For that, we have to give a full talk on women's rights in Islam. Or you can take my DVD with these on this topic, which will answer in detail. Hope that answers the question, sister.
Okay, I'll take a question from the brother here.
I am Dr. Sadek. My question was posed to me by one of my Hindu friend. According to him, he believes that Islam is the best religion and Quran is the best books of all the religious books. And in any discussions, Islamic scholars will always win the debates. And according to him, but the Muslims are suffering all over the world. They are non-progressive and there is a lot of problem among the Muslim world, Middle East or Far East, everywhere. So according to him, the Islam is a theoretical religion and not a practical religion. And if a religion is not acceptable by majority of people, how a religion can be followed?
Guru has a question that he likes Islam, he has read many lectures, he agrees with Islam. But throughout the world, the Muslims are in trouble, they are in problem. So Islam is a theoretical religion, not a practical religion. Whether in Islam, a person is in trouble, see here, the Quran says in Surah Mulk, chapter 67, verse number 2, Allazi khalaqal mauta wal hayata. It is Allah who has created death and life to test which of his good deeds. So just because a person is poor, that does not mean he fails the test. Just because the person is in misery, he does not fail the test. Just because he is in trouble, he does not fail the test. So this life is a test for thereafter. And I know that Muslims are on the receiving end. Why? Because the world, the Western world, they are against Islam. They are afraid that it will spread. So that all the luxury will go down. Whether they want to attack the various Muslim countries for power, for money, for oil. So what we realize, that irrespective, whenever any calamity befalls any human being, it is either a punishment or it's a test. Any good thing happens, it's either a reward or it's a test. So if there are Muslims who are being troubled, so we take it as a test from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah wants to test us. But in bad times, do we not believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or not? So one reason we are being troubled is many of the Muslims, previously the Muslims on top of the world, because we are close to the Quran and Sunnah. Now we are on the receiving end because we have gone away from Quran and Sunnah. So if you want to say Islam is a practical religion, the best example is during the time of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Khulafa Rashidin. It is a practical religion. Today, the Muslims have gone away from Quran and Sunnah, that is the reason we are receiving it. But yet, even if we are having problems, we Muslims should take it in the right spirit. As long as we are on the straight path, maybe Allah is testing us with difficulties. Do we yet believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And more difficult the test, more is the higher the reward. And our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that the messenger underwent a more severe test because they are getting a higher reward. So more difficult the test, and if you pass, higher is the reward. So pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, may He keep you on the straight path. Wa akhir da'wana, alhamdulillah rabbil alamin.
At the end of the lecture, we'd like to thank our speaker, Dr. Zakir Abdul Karim Naik, and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to reward him for being with us tonight. We'd like also to thank the National Guard for arranging for this lecture, and we'd like to thank you very much, brothers and sisters, for attending this lecture, and we hope to see you, inshallah, in coming lectures. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.